Yes, and I do want to apologize or say, confirm that no, you're, despite the day, you're not high. I'm not, in fact, Caroline Wong. She did a great job this week. I think she did five other presentations and panels up to almost getting to Friday morning. But I'll jump in, talk about some application security, and not even what the future of what the SaaS companies want, but really where are we today and what do we want today? Because I think that's extremely topical, and we'll approach it from a couple different directions. The idea of users, consumers of SaaS applications, as well as developers of SaaS applications. Because I'm pretty sure, regardless of what we think about our personal data usage, using things like Twitter, Facebook, et cetera, those exact same metaphors are possible as companies, as corporations. How are we developing similarly strong, secure applications? Or if we're consuming them, how do we build that trust and know that we're actually using secure, strong applications? So one of the things we'll start off with is just perhaps the obvious or nothing too profound about this in the sense of SaaS is taking over the world. It's a little bit of a riff on software is taking over the world. Or if you saw Alex Stamos's talk, I forget which conference, but it was now, but he gave a talk about AppSec is taking over the world. And that's really what this theme is. So what I've thrown up here, or what Caroline's provided us with, are some clouds, a good metaphor, and just some different ways of possibly inscrutable font, I apologize, but some metrics about why are we caring about software. And really, you know, what I would try to highlight here is that SaaS is inescapable. Even at a small company, we're a small company, Cobalt, we literally have more SaaS applications being used in our company than employees. So right there, as a consumer, you're already introducing challenges of identity management, credential management, let alone just trying to understand what data is, you know, leaving our so-called perimeter or leaving our network going to a third party. Should this data be going there? If it is, and we know about it, and it's approved, how is that data being protected? So these are a lot of things that we as a consumer of a SaaS, of much more than just one SaaS application, would want to know. So that's one of the things as we talk about that perspective of a vendor security questionnaire. What should really go on there so we can build that comfort level and essentially trust? So it's not so much talking really about, even though security is in the title, the underlying theme really is measuring risk and measuring trust. And that's really what we've got up here, some cloud metrics that are really saying, I'll try to pick one, 77% of companies plan to increase spending on the cloud. Sure, that makes sense. The way I'd sort of take that from a risk management perspective is that it's inevitable that the cloud is going to be used, whether you're using Salesforce, whether you're using a Workday, whether you're using a lot of things for internal HR, et cetera, they're being adopted. So the more important question is again, coming back to the idea of building trust and confidence that we're using a SaaS, or how do we evaluate a SaaS application? So what I wanted to hit is more, as I'm jumping around, I apologize, jumping between notes, is really the idea of the premise of the presentation is what's the future of application security for AppSec? The question is also phrased as how is the role of security changing? And I would also give if we're talking about questions, question zero, what are we actually protecting? So the role of security, I think it's impossible in this day and age to take that approach of thou shalt not do this, or if you're on the security team, no, you can't do this, or we're going to build a firewall, or we're going to block egress traffic. There's always going to be something that people use to get around that. There's always going to have to be an exception, and in the world of SaaS applications especially, everything is over port 443 anyway. It's all HTTPS. So security has to change from the perspective of, no, don't do that, to, that sounds hard, but let's make sure we do this securely. Or at least let me know what's going on, so we know what data is being collected in the SaaS application. So it's a much more collaborative model when we're talking about collecting, for example, and consuming SaaS applications rather than just that preventative model. So that's on the one hand. On the other hand, how is security changing as we're building those applications? So I'm jumping now between those two hats, now putting on that hat of developing the SaaS application. So now even application development happens quite a bit in the cloud, happens with tons of other SaaS tools. So you can possibly be using github.com. You might be using tools like CodeShip or other SaaS types of tools that are part of your CI/CD process, let alone how that CI/CD process looks like just through Google or Azure or AWS if you're using these. So again, I would set that premise there that the role of security is changing rather than coming in to overview and say, cool, you're about to release, let's do a pen test. Or you're about to release, show me what your SAS scanner did, or your code scanner, or your DAST, or your SAST. It should be more about you've been doing continuous integration, continuous development. Where are your security touch points along this process? And I think that is a key aspect of how security is changing with SaaS or with cloud-based development. It's more to say your application is going from a developer laptop that has secrets to a development shared environment to a staging environment to production environment. Key question number one, how are you managing secrets? How are you rotating keys? How are you making sure that the compromise of a developer laptop doesn't inherently and immediately create compromise of a production system so that the key, your SSL keys, for example, in a production systems can't be exfiltrated via bad code commits, or code commits can't go through your CI/CD process without at least being observed or at least being audited. So that's a really key way of how security is changing, because development is going so quickly, and there is, I think, a very good push in that sense of CI/CD, meaning rather than release on, you know, every six-week basis or every monthly basis, we're going to release on a two-week cadence, or even some companies aggressively releasing on a daily basis, for example, or multiple releases a day. And really what they're doing that in, is because of that, to throw the other word out there, that DevOps model, where they're building engineering feedback loops. They say code commit, test, and release, and make sure that release, we have monitoring, logging, et cetera, that we know we had confidence that we didn't break the system, break the build. Security now can be easily a part of that. Throw on linters to the IDEs, throwing on security touch points for the QA process. So this is where I'd say there's a lot of lip service perhaps that's been done about how it could or should be done, but I think that the cloud has enabled a lot of this to actually be feasible because these touch points can be tied onto the CI/CD process. So really what it's talking about then is to compare and contrast the old way of doing things and the new way of doing things in the sense of application development or developing SaaS applications, is that there's no such thing as our, you know, or we can't really talk about our old metaphors of onions and different layers of security around hosts or castles or et cetera, et cetera. The whole idea of SaaS is eating the world, or the Cloud Security Alliance, talking about, if you remember, recall like the Jericho Forum, or if you're familiar with the idea of zero trust models, for example. All of these are basically saying that your perimeter is no longer well defined at the host or at the network layer. It's more defined at the service layer. What are the data flows we're looking at? And that's really what it needs to be the emphasis on. And that's that idea of where is my data, where is it going, and how do we ask questions about that? So how do we approach a vendor security questionnaire, for example, if we want to shift back as a consumer of these cloud services, to be able to say, you know, did you deploy a firewall? Are you using antivirus? Those are kind of meaningless. It's more about what does your API look like? How are you handling authentication authorization? A key aspect there is how do these APIs integrate with other SaaS companies? So for example, you have a Salesforce, for example. has tons of small other platforms built on top of it. AWS, for example, has Heroku built on top of it. And all these services are really tied together via APIs. And the keys to the kingdom of these APIs are essentially passwords. We call them API tokens, we can call them OAuth tokens, but it's really just that small secret that gets passed around from service to service. So if we believe in, you know, if we take that parallel to the end user security, and we talk about passwords remain a notorious problem for end users, phishing remains an end user, there's got to be a very similar parallel to how these SaaS applications are talking to each other. How are these developers protecting those tokens? How are they protecting those S3 buckets on AWS? That seems to be the one of the risks of the day is that rather than just, you know, go try to do a significant phishing attack on an internal network, hop around, you just go through and enumerate somebody's AWS deployment, and you look for all those misconfigurations of their S3 buckets to expose personal data, consumer data, all this type of data. So it's one of those things that demonstrates how risky it can be when the cloud is open or when the SaaS is open. And I think the other point there, that third point, is everyone is distributed. Everyone's sitting at coffee shops. They're sitting at conferences. They're sitting at companies. They're sitting at home. They're traveling, et cetera. So again, that's just that idea of your end users are in different locations. So now you need to tie more towards identity and ask that question of, do you trust me? And so this is where talking about more, using the term risk and trust rather than security in the sense of application security, and in using those in the sense of spectrum. So a good example here is what if, you know, we have, for example, a SaaS platform. I worked at prior companies that were very much SaaS platforms. And the common question was, why should I trust you? You know, I'm giving you this data. It's sensitive data either about exploit information, about network scanning information. Perhaps it's personal information that's now protected by GDPR. So at the end of May, this question of do you trust me, or why should I trust you, or how much can I trust you, is going to be even bigger as we see more companies responding and updating privacy policies related to GDPR. But if we try to take this from a vendor security questionnaire model, we have sort of this infamous riddle of, I think, the riddle of the Sphinx or the two-door riddle of the labyrinth, where you're presented with two doors and two guardians. You can ask one question. One guardian always tells the truth. One guardian always lies. And so you have to figure out which door to go through to be safe, or which SaaS platform to put your data on to be safe. And if you want to find out the secret of how to beat that riddle, I'll throw some pop culture at you and go look at the movie Labyrinth, or go look up the Pyramids of Mars episode for you Doctor Who fans. But essentially, this idea of trust is trying to figure out what components are in place protecting this data. So some of those concrete aspects would be, or should be, how often is security being tested? So I alluded earlier to the CI/CD model of development, so continuous integration, continuous deployment. Applications are being updated, either minor tweaks or perhaps major tweaks on a daily, weekly, sprint-based basis. If you're doing annual pen testing and part of your vendor security questionnaire is just saying, show me your last pen test, show me your last annual pen test, that's perhaps informative, but it's not necessarily the best information because it just means at this one particular point in time, way back in December of 2017, somebody did a pen test and the code at that time looked pretty good. A different way to approach that is asking, what is your security model, or what's your maturity model? You know, what controls do you have in place to test security? And the answers there may come around frequency of testing. So maybe they do an actual quarterly penetration testing. If they fall under PCI, it's more likely they'll be able to handle that frequency. But one of the signs there of asking about the frequency of something like penetration testing or external security testing is that there must be a maturity model in order to have somebody that just knows this is necessary, knows to collect that information, and then actually fixes the vulnerabilities or fixes any risks that's identified from there. So companies always have problems, whether they're big or small. Application has bugs. So something like, and that's one of the reasons that bug bounties are so huge and so profitable for many of the bug bounty participants. Software is just messy. So being able to ask a vendor not, have you done a pen test, but what is your approach to security testing can often be more informative. That idea of that basic concept of an open-ended question and see how they handle frequency. How quickly do they resolve vulnerabilities? Because if we set the premise that we know systems are going to be compromised, et cetera, if we know that a vulnerability is going to be identified, like a struts vulnerability gets announced, if it's very common or very easy for an organization to be able to identify their asset inventory or they're able to respond with a story about how they manage their asset inventory, their software inventory, that's pretty informative. If they're also able to be able to explicitly say, we have a 24 SLA for P1 security issues, a 7-day and a 30-day perhaps for P2 and P3 issues, that's informative, perhaps aspirational, but if they were able to give you, this is how often we meet that SLA, that's a very strong signifier of a mature company because it boils down to metrics and measuring what they both care about and what they can do. Meaning they care about security in the sense of, we don't just want to do security testing so we can get some boilerplate language and, you know, pass a check mark on a vendor security questionnaire. We want to do some security testing, respond to it in a way that will actually fix our application. So this is where is one of the themes that boils down to that aspect of, do you trust me? The other aspect of it is fourth party, fifth party, sixth party, et cetera. So when I was talking about pen testing and vulns and bug bounties, SAST scanner, so source analysis, dynamic analysis, a lot of these I think are pretty much uniformly, all of them are focused on application or what we would call the shorthand, the OWASP top 10. Cross-site scripting, SQL injection, cross-site request forgery, and so on. But if you were to take a little bit closer look at all those particular vulnerabilities or weaknesses, none of them really explicitly call out data or data handling, or even to a good degree call out privacy. We could possibly make a case that insecure use of crypto or weak crypto relates to data privacy. We could possibly make the case that privilege escalation or business logic relates to that idea of data, but it doesn't explicitly call it out. So this is where I think there's, if I'm talking back and reflecting on the AppSec community and the top 10 list that we provide, or the way that we interrogate vendors about what security programs are you doing, we're missing a lot of those aspects on data handling. So what data are you collecting? Do you have fourth parties that are managing that data, either from aggregate metadata around it that you're allowed to resell, or are they just storing it for you? So for example, just because it's at the top of my head, I'm familiar with it, that relationship between Heroku and AWS. So for example, using AWS as a provider. Plenty of SaaS companies are deployed on AWS and Azure and Google for that matter. But the question comes in, you know, the easy way to ask this question is, what is your multi-tenant strategy? Or how do you separate multiple tenants? So that's the shorthand. It's really asking, is my data commingled with other data? And it's another way of asking, are you encrypting this data? Because if you have separate tenants and separate tenant data is not commingled, that probably means, which is a good thing, that you can encrypt this tenant with this key and this other tenant with this other key. So these are ways of kind of diving in to actually getting more details and the sense of how a SaaS company can protect data, or if they've even thought about it. So for example, if that response to protecting multi-tenant data is, you know, we have it based on role-based access, that probably means there's not encryption on the back end. So these are just some ways of being able to identify and go through how you're talking about these scenarios. So one of the ways, one of the themes I'm trying to bring up here is I talk about asking these questions or measuring the level of maturity or measuring how does a company manage security is that idea of a maturity model. My colleague Caroline, she has a fantastic background and does a lot of work around BSIM. So that's one way of measuring, a very good, relatively objective way of measuring and comparing and contrasting maturity of an organization. For me, I'll have to punt slightly on that slide and shift to something I'm more familiar with in the sense of the NIST cybersecurity framework. So this one, I think, is becoming much more, many companies are aligning around it, looking towards it, because it has both of the aspects of protecting your application, but it acknowledges that you're going to be hacked. Every company out there is going to be compromised. So the reason you do a pen test is not to spend money to get a report that you can then hand off to a customer and says, we did a pen test because we know that PCI asks for it or that you've asked for all your other vendors for it. You do that because you want to check the hygiene of your SDLC process. You want to figure out what gaps have been missed. Was it just a human error that produced this cross-site scripting? Or was there some architectural mistake? So for example, with cross-site scripting, if you're writing your front end in React, React.js, the Facebook project that's been open sourced, you're probably going to be very, very resistant to cross-site scripting because it's very difficult to make that cross-site scripting mistake as a developer using React. You actually have to go out of your way to make such a mistake. So there's an example of having a more mature choices and architecture in your model. But tying this back to the NIST and the cybersecurity framework, the three key aspects of that are starting with the premise that you're going to be compromised. Can you detect that compromise? Can you respond to that compromise? And how can you recover? And if we start to go into asking as a part of a vendor security questionnaire, that can be some very challenging questions, and those can be very illuminating questions at a high degree to figure out, how is this company protecting my data? So there are a lot of statistics about the idea of dwell time, or how long hackers or APT entities sit on networks. If my memory is going to serve me correctly, Mandiant just put out a report for 2017, and I believe the average number was around 100 days of dwell time. That means you've been compromised in some manner, someone clicked on a phishing link, somebody committed credentials to a public GitHub account, and those credentials now were used to access a cloud service provider, et cetera. But the attackers gained a foothold, and now the backdoor is on your network. The best backdoor in the world are legit credentials, a username and password. Best backdoor, and they're going to sit there for 100 days. So one of the questions either you can ask is, what's your IR methodology, or what's your IR process, or what is your notification process for me as a consumer? So what are your thresholds to be able to say, yes, we've actually had a breach or we've had an incident? Does it actually only happen if my data has been confirmed to be touched? Meaning that you have some log or some DLP that can indicate, Mike at Cobalt's email address actually left the network or was in this S3 bucket that was clearly accessed. Or would that notification preferably be done if there is a suspicion or, it doesn't have to just be my records that were exposed. So these are different ways of asking and going towards that vendor security questionnaire. So I think, again, this idea that secure software is business critical, yes, that's kind of a truism. It's more a way, I guess I would say, if we wanted to have an intelligent conversation around it, or a deeper conversation, let me put it that way, is that every business is using some type of software. And it's more likely now that they're using SaaS applications, because they're more easy to access, they're more easy to spin up. they're actually a lot easier to manage with that small asterisk of credentials and identity management around them, meaning do they offer multi-factor authentication, et cetera. But the idea here is, what could we be doing different, or why are we just still relying on the same vendor security questionnaires that are saying, have you done an annual pen test? Do you have antivirus running on your systems? Do you have a firewall? They need to be a lot more mature. Dive into those questions about, perhaps even, this may be too specific, but what is the release process? How does that look in the sense of a CI/CD? And are they agile? How often might the application be changing? And how fast can they respond to bugs? So I guess that's more of what I was trying to get there is, a vulnerability gets reported, how quickly can they respond? And do they tell you? Do they give you number? Everyone, or a lot of them talk about, the number of nines for their uptime, 5 nines, 6 nines, et cetera. But probably what they don't talk about is the SLA in bug fixing. How often do they hit a 7 day or 24 hours, et cetera, et cetera? How many of those are P1 or P2 bugs, things like that? And a lot of times, if I were asking those questions, I probably would put less emphasis on what was the vulnerability and more emphasis on how quickly were those vulnerabilities resolved. So the other thing is that humans are always part of this equation. So I come from a background of during the dawn of the web, if you will, before the OWASP top 10 was even an OWASP top 10 list, doing manual penetration testing. Then I shifted into automating that, doing web application scanners. And I think today the DevOps or DevSecOps model, I think is fantastic because it automates so many things. And if I was going to go on a tangent to possibly thing that I'm even more passionate about is that security, we can create systems as code. We can create security as code. One of the things I really didn't highlight yet in talking about like SaaS and these applications is that not only can you take your React.js, not only can you take your C#, your .NET, your Ruby, your Go, your Rust, what your language is, but you can also start to use APIs for your infrastructure. And this is one of those things. Those APIs for your infrastructure means how can you spin up systems on Google, on AWS? How even can you even use like serverless architectures using something like Lambda? But the reason that developers and a lot of organizations are moving towards containers is not because they want to necessarily because just want to save money and condense and create a better density of applications running on hardware, but you can also abstract into text files what your network looks like. You can have a YAML structure that says, these systems represent these backend data structures, these are the APIs they call out to, these are the RPMs that go onto it, et cetera. And then you have another blob of text that does this. So now, rather than managing your infrastructure and sending people down hallways or down rows and rows of data center, you're dealing with text files. And you're dealing with text files, humans will still make mistakes, humans still need to have that insight about them, but you can also start doing those simple things of linting and looking for mistakes and saying, what does the text file that describes my entire AWS infrastructure when I spin up, spin down systems look like? And it's a lot easier to reason and be able to secure that. So I think that's one of the reasons we see things like Kubernetes, containers, really, really take off. And it speaks a little bit to the idea of we have a lot of specialization in the sense of roles of security. So DevOps is taking on a lot of those responsibilities to say security is part of how we manage our keys for our website. So we're dealing with our HSMs in the cloud. That's a developer or an operations responsibility. Security should just be able to consult with them or work with them to make sure that architecture is being done in a way that maintains security around those keys. That there are tools to be able to check for when developers commit those API tokens, those private keys to a public GitHub, they can be taken down, and more importantly, you can rotate keys. That is probably one of the biggest things if you're part of the product security team or the security team, don't just ask, how are you storing your keys? In a way, just ask, your key has been compromised. How can you go and rotate it, and how long will that take? And it's really that idea of moving to agility, moving quickly. I'm a big fan of that automation, that CI/CD process, and finding touch points where you have visibility into that application, dropping security onto that. So, wrapping up, this is wanted to give give a sense of, look at what your vendor security questionnaire right now is for your company. What are you asking them? And do you think that's giving you informative answers? You know, are you asking a yes or no question in the sense of, do you do annual pen testing? Or are you asking that open-ended question of, how often do you do security testing? What type of security testing do you do? Those answers can be helpful, but that just says, yes, we know about security, we care about security, because to also be slightly cynical, a lot of companies need to care about that because they just want to be able to sell and check that box off and yet and say, yes, we meet GDPR, we meet, you know, Privacy Shield, we meet PCI, we meet this other, you know, requirement, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But getting into not just do you care about security, but how do you measure that? In other words, asking about that SLA, asking about how do you respond, how do you handle vulnerabilities that are reported from the public. So it's not so much, for example, do you have, you know, how, what does your bug bounty program look like, or how bad, you know, how much have you spent $1 million this year on a bug bounty program, and the implication is that all of your software must be terrible. It's more about, do you have a way to even triage and manage vulnerabilities that are reported from the community? Because we've seen in, just in the last couple of months, good and not so good, to use a word, were ways of handling a researcher who says, I iterated through this number in this URL parameter, and you have a problem. Or I found I was able to download a list of everyone's first name, last name, email address, and last four digits of their credit card off of your application. This is a problem. So how companies react to that is also a sign of security maturity. And that can be one of those great ways of you know, having a vendor security questionnaire, asking one question, but looking for a subtext to see how they answer it, and getting a sense of how mature is this company that we're working with. And so, you know, if I were to say, I think RSA is always like have an apply slide, or you know, these are the three bullet points that you have to do, so it's something to take home with, would be, if you haven't done any security testing around your application, plan one. But don't just say, well, we need to do this because we want to check a box. Figure out how you're going to respond to those vulnerabilities. Because if you've never done any security testing, it's going to be the application Swiss cheese. You're going to get a lot of vulnerabilities. So, or if you've never started a security program and you open up a bug bounty program and you have the hordes of the internet come in, they're going to drain that bug bounty budget, and there's going to be a lot of noise to handle, and there's going to be a lot of personalities to deal with. So it's much as a social exercise as it is a preparation or a development exercise. So go into this type of security testing with some plans about how to do it on a continuous basis or a frequent basis. In this case, you haven't done it before. Continuous doesn't mean daily, weekly, monthly. It's probably going to mean semi-annual, quarterly, but then figuring out how you're automating that and closing that. And if, you know, that would be, I guess, those two things, revisit that questionnaire, revisit how you're approaching security testing, are the two themes I would leave you with. So I do want to give a shout out to Caroline, who may have a little Caroline by now, or coming soon. So I want to thank her for the chance to fill in. And I also appreciate everyone here who came in on a Friday morning at the end of RSA. So I think I've left some time for questions. So I'll say thank you, and with that time, answer questions. We have microphones, or yeah, fantastic. Okay.
So we are building an application level encryption platform, and my question would be, how can I? I haven't seen a lot of automation going around in validating encryption. So what's your perspective on that, on automating that process?
So if I understand, detecting on the use of encryption or the misuse, like a misconfiguration of encryption.
the use, the every aspect that is related to encryption then.
So I think if I'll try to rephrase it in a way to make sure I understand. So, you know, what are the automatic ways of detecting data is protected, both in transit and at rest, basically encryption, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so the couple ways, you know, in transit, that is when your system architecture, your service level architecture, everything, even on your internal VPCs or AWS, it's all SSL. And in key places, key or important places, even potentially mutual service authentication. So that's one way to say, if this is our default, we want mutual authentication between our microservices. It's a lot easier then to look for, to basically grep through code or look for patterns of that lack of use. In terms of automatically finding it, I don't have, you know, that still is cumbersome. The other way I guess I'd try to answer that is that a lot of the cloud service providers have your instance, you can spin up an instance that has an encrypted file system by default. So you can use CryptoFS on Linux, and that is fantastic because, you know, your deletion policy now is delete the key rather than try to shred and go through over, you know, how many passes people want to debate over a hard disk. So just that default deploying CryptoFS on your Linux systems by default says at least those systems are protected on the one hand if they were when they're shut down. When they're running, obviously it's decrypted, and you have that other question about key management. So I think I don't have a good answer on automatically detecting where is, you know, basically saying this is data that needs to be encrypted. This is how I detect that it is encrypted, rather it's just base64 or it's been poorly XORed, other than to say, revisit from the architecture perspective and say, what is your mutual authentication, what's your mutual authentication or authorization you're doing between microservices or services, and what is your solution for CryptoFS, and importantly, how you're managing the keys for those encrypted systems. So I hope that helped.
Yeah, thanks. That would basically mean that most of the automatic things are for existing SSL and standard facilities.
Yeah. So these, what's fantastic is the all these service providers have these crypto primitives available. So it's not even, you don't have to roll your own crypto. It's that it's all APIs. And so you can interact with the APIs just as you would with another identification API. So that's why things that is a great encouragement to go into the cloud because you can still protect data there.
Thanks. So my question on my end of things, I am a consumer of SaaS services, right? I'm not a software developer or anything like that. That's not what my company does. When looking at it, one concern obviously is around, you know, the vendor security and what they offer and making sure that we feel comfortable using their service. The other goes around how are we consuming that service securely? So you imagine we have our on-premise functions, features, all those type of capabilities, then we're leveraging multiple SaaS parties as well, combining that together to handle some type of service orchestration across a hybrid cloud environment. How are we making sure that we're doing that in a secure manner, understanding that data that we have is trusted and secure that's on-premise is now being taken across the cloud to areas that we've never investigated before? And just handling all that management. So controls, recommendations, capabilities.
Yeah, so again, I'm as much as I like pithy phrases and alliteration, I'm not one for succinct answers. So one of the things, so two things that come to the top of my mind are, you know, how robust is your data classification policy and your data handling policy? So if you have a good data classification policy and you can at least say, here are the categories of our public data, here is what our, you know, and our levels of sensitivity, and you actually have something that's defined, this is allowed to go off-premise or this must stay on-premise, that's a fantastic start right there. Because then one of the ways then, in program development and risk management approach is to say, as people want to come and onboard SaaS application foo, SaaS application X, Y, and Z, one of the questions to them is, you know, identify who that internal business owner is. What data are you putting out there? What data does that application incidentally also collect? So that way you just also have now a classification that says, Application A maps to this type of data that's sitting out on the, you know, their system somewhere. So at least now you have a manifest. And one of the reasons I just say that and going back to that policy is that look at like the SANS top four, the SANS top five again, is that they're my philosophy of security is that asset inventory is very difficult and very important. And so that data version is equivalent to that. So that's why I'd say data classification, understanding what the business owners are expecting that they put in there, going through the vendor security questionnaire, asking that same question, and make sure that what the business owner was expecting actually matches what the vendor says. Because the business owner aren't going to necessarily be security, you know, sophisticated in security or understand the nuances and so on. So that would be basically the process way I'd go about it. The other angle I would also add, especially as you have applications, multiple SaaS applications interacting with each other, is figure out how to change tokens. Basically, how to do a password change, or say, you know, one of our developers was doing, writing a Python script to help, glue together these two APIs. Our API token got published to GitHub or published to Pastebin, et cetera. What is the process for changing that? And if there's anything, it's reactive, but that's one of the things that I would recommend too, is being prepared to be able to say, there was a compromise, not even necessarily of our data, but we suspect there was a compromise, we're worried about it. How quickly, how long is it going to take? Well, one, who do we know to go talk to? So you have that business owner, you have a contact with the vendor, and then two, who's our internal developer security team to go and rotate all those API tokens? Because if there's one little trap of having like OAuth and these types of setups, is that sure, you have a username and password that I might have multi-factor auth, maybe you rotate it every once in a while, but those OAuth tokens can sit there for 6 months, 12 months, 2 years even, and be completely forgot about. So I guess that would be the other really thing that I would highlight, just enable to make sure you have good security.
Cool. All right, thank you.
Thank you.
I was wondering if you'd like to share an example of real-time security automation that you've actually seen in the SaaS environment.
So it's a great question. It's a very open-ended question. So I'm trying to think of a really good answer. I think for me, previously, what would be great? So real-time automation was as simple as a very janky, because that's a technical term, web application scanner that was looking only for cross-site scripting in certain reflected fields. So basically, cross-site scripting for this one particular application, notoriously horrible problem. People are always making mistakes. It was legacy code. So one of the things there was to say, you know what? We could go on this mantra and all these discussions about false positives, whether vendors are good, bad, security scanners, et cetera. But it's more of like, let's avoid those conversations altogether and say, we only care about this one type of vulnerability. And we're going to put together some scripts, some Selenium scripts to check for it. And we're going to have the developers implement and manage this security of it. And we're just going to help them do it, but they take the responsibility. So the reason I call that out as successful automation is that security was helping the engineering team deploy essentially a security check themselves to manage a security check. And they were doing it in a way that sort of, if you will, gets their feet wet to say cross-site scripting was notoriously a problem. It's not the worst vulnerability even out there, I would say, but now they understand it. And that is a stepping stone, which we didn't do or haven't done yet, but that was a stepping stone to be able to say, what other types of security checks now can we build into that? So that would be one example. Another example I will actually say is perhaps not in a way of, maybe this is automation, but maybe this is more architecture, is just throwing like a WAF or throwing like some type of protection in front of an application so that it can be fronted by something that's a filter that takes care of a lot of input validation traffic, a lot of simple flaws that legacy code can't handle. So that's why I'm thinking of some challenges of handling automation around legacy code, because that's where it's really harder to handle. Better automation, I would say, really is just is that stronger linting and Git check-ins. So I think if that's going to be my other answer to that, is that other end of the development life cycle, the CI/CD process, is having a server-side linter for your Git check-ins that says, why have you used this dangerously set inner HTML React function? Don't do that. Or here is a function that shouldn't be called out of just development policy. Or here is a code comment with a lot of entropy that looks like it might be followed by like a password, something like that. Or even more strictly, you've just committed code that has the word to do in it. Why is that? So it's a way of basically reminding and calling out to developers and saying, not in the sense of we're watching you, Orwellian approach, but moving to be able to say, here's some basic code hygiene, and clean code, I believe, could be more secure code. So that would be, I guess, the other example of that automation, that simple linting on Git check-ins. And I think I've been given the 1 minute sign, so I think we're out of time. I think you have lunch next or something coming up. But thank you once again for attending, especially on this Friday morning. Appreciate it.